Anita Wright Chaudhry. I'm the principal of Wells Community Academy High School, this gorgeous Art Deco era building you're sitting in right now. Wells is a traditional neighborhood public high school that offers comprehensive and rigorous academic programming, along with a wide range of arts and other extracurricular options, social-emotional learning opportunities, and much more. Wells is committed to developing the whole child with personalized attention to their needs and set them on their path towards success in college, career, and in life. Families who experience Wells call it a hidden gem. Unfortunately, despite being a neighborhood high school, only 40% of our student body actually come from the neighborhood. Why is this the case? We will explore bits of that today in today's session while we dig into why neighborhood schools are great options for students and great places for the community to find common ground. You're about to hear a few thoughts from Wells freshman Dorian Thompson. He is from the neighborhood and despite many options, chose Wells. After Dorian, the executive director of Generation All, Beatrice Ponce de Leon, will transition us into the program for this evening. I hope you all have an eye-opening and informative evening. Thank you.
To take a look at the education ecosystem in Chicago, and especially to shine a spotlight on our neighborhood high schools. So I really thank you for coming out tonight to be part of this discussion. We have a couple things to go through before we get started. And first, I just want to ask you if you all picked up a folder at the front. The folder contains some articles related to this work, also resources from the Chicago Community Trust. Like one, just raise your hand. It's something that we can get to you in a minute. Okay, and in this day of technology, we're very active on social media. So if any of you are on Twitter or on Facebook, I invite you to post while you're at the event. We would love for you to share this with the people that follow your accounts. This is really part of generating discussion across the city about our public schools and specifically our neighborhood public high schools. So there should be a raise your hand, which is what our lead host, and then also a hashtag. We're trying to use today the hashtag CPS success and also neighborhood high schools matter. So all of that is in your program and I really encourage you to use that. There should be Wi-Fi here at Wells that's available to us. If you could find that, I think you should be able to log on. And then one more thing, just before we get started, I want to say thank you to people that helped to put this program together. So thank you to the Generation All team. There are several of us running around, but especially Ms. Susu Schneider, who is about to have a baby in a week, and she managed to pull this program together. Thank you to our co-hosts. We have a group of co-hosts. Raise your hand. And their volunteers are here working the registration. We have the Network for College Success from the University of Chicago, the Grow Community, and Solorio Academy High School. And all of them helped to get the word out about this event, so thank you so much for that. And then finally, just thanks to the parents and the students who will be sharing their perspectives with you in our fishbowl discussion with youth, and then in our panel discussion with parents and the principal. And of course, our two kind of celebrity guests, we have Linda Lutton from WBZ, who will be moderating the conversation, and Elaine Allensworth, the director of the consortium at the University of Chicago. We thought that this program was a fitting combination of the research, what the research has told us or is telling us about CPS outcomes and about students in Chicago Public Schools, and then also the perspectives of the families that are the users of our Chicago Public Schools. So we hope that what we share with you today will inspire you to look beyond school ratings and test scores, to take a second look at some other schools, and also to know what questions to ask as you make some decisions for yourselves and your families. So with that, I would like to introduce Elaine. I'll just give you a quick overview of her background. Elaine Allensworth is the Lewis Sebring Director of the University of Chicago Consortium on School Research, where she conducts studies on what matters for student success and for school improvement. Her research has been used across the country to create tracking systems such as Freshmen on Track here in Chicago and in other districts that are being used to make sure that students are on a path to graduate from high school and are prepared for success post-high school. In addition to studying educational attainment, Elaine conducts research in the areas of school leadership and school organization, and she frequently works with policymakers and practitioners to bridge research and practice as part of panel discussions such as this one, on policy commissions, in working groups, and in a variety of other settings in both local, state, and national organizations. Elaine has received a number of awards and has published numerous journal articles and studies. Her work is frequently covered in the local and national media, including the New York Times, the Chicago Tribune, Public Radio, Ed Week, and CNN. And we are really excited to have Elaine join us today. Thank you, Elaine.
Four-year graduation rates are even higher if you look 5 years. still have a ways to go, but you know, a lot of schools are now getting close to almost all students graduating. We have way more students who are getting it to the end of high school. They're graduating. People have been saying, well, but is that real? Are students just being pushed through? Well, if that were true, we would expect that college outcomes would be worse, right? But in fact, we're seeing way more students are graduating high school, and at the same time, a larger percentage of those students are enrolling in four-year colleges. And on top of that, among those students enrolling in four-year colleges, they're actually graduating from college at higher rates than ever before. Right? So we're seeing improvements all the way through to four-year college graduation. Now we can continue. A lot of those improvements have been driven by neighborhood high schools. So all types of schools in Chicago have seen dramatic improvements in just about any student achievement outcome that you could care about. Certainly high school graduation rates, also ACT scores, college outcomes. But neighborhood high schools have seen the biggest improvements. And in fact, it used to be that charter high schools in Chicago had higher graduation rates than neighborhood high schools. But that's not the case anymore. Neighborhood high schools have caught up to charter schools. And all schools continue to see improvements in graduation rates, improvements in ACT scores, improvements in college outcomes. And in fact, we now have thousands and thousands more students making it to the end of the junior year to take the ACT than we used to have 10 years ago. 5,000 more students are actually taking the ACT. You would think with so many students moving through and taking the ACT, you might see a drop in ACT scores. So students are just moving through, you think, well, maybe they're not doing as well. But we've seen the opposite. More students are making it to the end of the junior year. ACT scores are going up. Students are actually in school more. They're learning more. They're doing better. They're taking way more AP classes than they are used to. And also more students are passing AP classes. We have thousands and thousands of students taking AP classes every single year. And we also see some improvements in students' grading averages. So more students are graduating. They're graduating with higher achievement. This is a success story that I don't think gets told enough. I should also mention that students make higher gains on tests in Chicago than on average in the country, in the 100 largest districts in the country, and also in the rest of Illinois, by far. So students are learning more in Chicago schools than they are in schools in other places. Okay, so, you know, yes, Chicago schools are doing a lot better, but there's still a lot of variation, right? There's a lot of differences in high schools across Chicago. And you know, it can be very challenging to figure out, well, you know, what are the different options for schools in Chicago? Certainly, there are a lot of different neighborhood schools, and because we're an open enrollment system, you can apply to go to neighborhood schools that are, you know, not where you are not in the attendance area. And of course, there are programs within schools. I can't even list all the programs. Some of the big ones that people know about are the IB program, CPE. There are selective enrollment high schools, there are charter high schools, and then there are lots of different specialty schools. You know, way too many to list. You know, you can look them up, and I'm going to give you information on where you can look up all the different kinds of schools. You know, there are 150 high schools, and then when you start thinking about all the programs within the high schools, that can easily get overwhelming. One thing that we know from research is that when people have more than, say, four, you know, people like to have choices, it's good to have choice, but if you give people more than, say, four or five choices, a lot of times they just stop even thinking about it, right? So you don't want to be overwhelmed by thinking about every single school in the district, right? You want to try to focus, focus your search. And there are different ways you can do that. And you can easily focus it down to a much more manageable number. The number one thing, I think, as most of you would probably know, is can you get there on time every day? And it seems really obvious. Okay. Seems like a really obvious thing. But the number one reason that students fail classes, by far, is that they don't show up or that they're tardy. So getting there every day on time has to be the number one thing. Coming to every class every day that you're not too sick to be there.
in the selective programs and selective schools, we may need to submit, or they choose based on your prior test scores, and their achievements in the middle grade, their neighborhood boundaries, their lotteries, their charter schools. They all have different admissions requirements. So I guess you don't know for sure where you're going to go. But you can have an idea of where it's likely that you will be able to be. And that also can reduce your choice set quite a bit. I'm going to talk about some of those different kinds of schools. We see a lot of people, they'll just apply to Whitney Young and Lane Tech, and that's it. They've made their choices, right? But when you look at those applications, a lot of people apply just to those schools, even though they actually have really no chance of getting into those schools, right? So if there's information available from CPS for the selective schools, you can go to schools and find out about the enrollment criteria, and you can actually figure out, is this a school that you have a good chance of getting into? You don't want to game it or anything. You want to apply to the schools that you really want to go to, but when you're thinking about your choice set, you want to make sure you're considering schools that you actually can get into. There are a lot of charter schools and specialty schools that may, be really great for some students, but they may have a very specific kind of culture. Maybe the schools are going to try to be more general and serve a wide variety of students. Maybe the charter schools, a lot of times, are serving a very particular kind of student. So you want to find out about the culture and the expectations at the school. And then there's issues of quality, and I'm going to spend most of my time talking about that. Because it's really hard to judge schools a lot of times. What should you look at? Should you look at academics, graduation, and college outcomes, school climate? All of those things are really important. Okay, so what are some of the factors that matter for student success? So you want to go to a school that's going to add value to you, right? Where you are going to be particularly successful. And that's not going to be the same for every person. But we do see that students tend to be more successful than when they go to schools that are, first of all, safe and supportive. Certainly students do better in school when they feel like they're getting a lot of personalized support and attention from their teachers, where they feel like instruction is clear, where they feel like they're challenged, but they're not overly challenged without support. So you want to be challenged, you want to be supported. Students are more likely to go to college if they're in school with a strong college-going culture. And schools are more likely to be successful if they have teachers that work well together with each other and that work well with families. And you can get information on all of this online, and I'm going to tell you where you can get that information. Now, you also want to go to a school that's strong academically. But it can be really hard to figure out if a school is strong academically because it does a great job educating its students, or it looks strong because it gets a lot of academically talented students in the first place. If you're getting stronger students in the first place, you don't have to do as much in order to look good on performance metrics. And likewise, there's some schools that may not look as strong, but they're serving students that come in, say, with much lower test scores weaker attendance in the middle grades, and they actually are able to get students to have stronger performance in high school. So we've been trying to figure out, to what degree can you use data that's out there on school performance to know whether you would benefit from going to a selective school or a school that looks good on performance metrics. So I'm going to very briefly summarize a couple of studies here, and we can talk more about it, and I'm going to tell you where you can get more information too about these. Okay, so one thing we look at is, what do you get from going to a selective high school? Now, only students with very, very high achievement can get into a selective high school. So selective high schools, on performance metrics, they look amazing because they only accept very, very high achieving students. And what we find is that students definitely report a strong academic climate in the schools, but we don't see that they actually add any value to most academic outcomes beyond what students get in high-performing neighborhood and charter schools. So you see some
made no difference that they went to a selective school on average. And then we see some worse outcomes. So that students who go to a selective school end up with lower GPAs than they likely would have had at another school. They're lower in their class rank. And for some students, they end up less likely to go to private selective colleges. Right? Because when you go to a selective school, it is much more challenging. All of the students are very, very high achieving. When the work is really challenging, it means it's harder to get good grades, and that actually can affect your later outcomes. And for a lot of kids also, it makes a difference where you are relative to your peers. I mean, there's a lot of advantages in terms of being around a lot of strong, high achieving students, but at the same time, for a lot of students, they're suddenly in an environment where they had never struggled in elementary school, and now, everyone else is getting it. It may not be as easy. And unless they're getting support, they can just struggle when they get to high school. Okay, so that's what we see about selective schools. So what about schools that are not selective, but they actually look good on performance metrics? They have high graduation rates, they have high test scores compared to other neighborhood schools and charter schools. These are schools that don't select students on the basis of their prior achievement. Well, for these schools, we actually do see benefits from attending them. Okay. We see lots of better outcomes, peer interactions, behavior again, better safety, instructional quality, challenge, improved study habits, improved attendance, better ACT scores, higher rates of college enrollments, higher rates of college assistance. Mindsets are incredibly powerful. Your belief of
These are things that strongly influence how students do at school. And so you want to go to a school that's really paying attention to the ninth grade. And there is data out there, I'm going to show you where that is, where you can actually compare schools serving similar students. How are students doing in the ninth grade year? What is the difference in their ninth grade on the path? In ninth grade, to be on track for graduation means no more than one semester course failure in ninth grade. To be on track for college basically means getting B's or better in your classes, having a 3.0 GPA or higher. Another thing that people always mention, oh, it's no big deal coming to school. The number one reason students fail classes is because they're not coming. And the number one reason students end up not college ready is because they're not coming every day. So you also want to look, what is the attendance at level in these schools? We see that schools serving similar students oftentimes have very different rates of attendance. And attendance is what actually drives college readiness as well as driving high school graduation. A lot of students, when they move from 8th to 9th grade, they start missing a lot more classes. In fact, absence is quadruple. I don't think students are sick 4 times as often in 9th grade as 8th grade. But you really want to pay attention to what's happening in that ninth grade year, because it can really, a lot of students see a decline in performance. Okay, so I've talked about a lot of things about high school. Please consider looking at school information. One thing is you want to look holistically. There are always going to be trade-offs. I've already talked about some of the trade-offs that exist. You want to look at lots of different indicators of what's happening in school. You also want to talk to people. Talk to people at the school, talk to people in your community, find out about the schools. You want to judge school quality not based on who it serves as much as how it's doing with the students that it serves. So you want to compare schools that are serving similar types of students. And remember, one year may not be representative. So you want to look, is this a school that's been doing well over time, or that looks like it's, and there's a lot of information that's out there in schools. This PowerPoint will be available for you all if you want it. There's a lot of basic information about high schools that CPS puts out. They put out the cut scores for every selected enrollment school, and they have a calculator. So you can figure out what your score would be for the selected enrollment schools, and then you can see which schools you have a high likelihood of getting in. That you can find the neighborhood schools, you can find out what your neighborhood school is, where you have automatic admission. There's also a high school bounce site where you can see photos and videos of schools. And then there's a lot of places you can look for information on school quality. So you can get school performance data and data on demographic composition of schools from CPS. You can get all that school climate information about sense of safety and their importance of support from teachers and the degree to which they're challenged from the 5 essential surveys, the My Voice, My School survey site. And we can also, through the 2 and 3 project site, you can see for every high school what their 9th grade on track rate is, what their college enrollment rate is, what colleges their students are going to after high school, what those their college graduation rates are. So you can actually see what's happening to students all the way from 9th grade to college graduation at every high school in the city. And the site allows you to compare schools serving similar students and look at changes over time. So you get a lot of information like that. So I've thrown a lot of things at you. Hope it's not too much. You can get more information on our website, the consortium at chicago.edu. And this PowerPoint will be available. Thank you.
Thank you, Lily. I'm going to ask you to do a quick turn and talk. So we have a question up here. What is something you just learned from this presentation that was new for you, and how might it impact your process of choosing or supporting schools? And then we'll have opportunity for a couple questions directly for Elaine. Elaine will also be on the panel discussion a little later. So please find a partner and have a conversation about the talk. So you'll just see, try to do
schools, some are probably adding value while others aren't. But, you know,
Can you repeat that again, please?
What?
Can you repeat what he asked?
He just asked about the new common application, which CPS has been working on for a while. But I don't, you know, we haven't studied it, so I don't want to comment on it.
Does any of your research cover how attendance to academic centers impact student success in high school?
We haven't studied that. I'm sorry. That's a good question.
All right, thank you, Elaine.
Thank you.
And if you'd like to see more of the research, you can visit the University of Chicago Consortium on School Research. We also will have a PDF of the slides available on our website at generationallchicago.org. So we're transitioning now. We heard some of what the research says. We talked about choices and options. And now we will have a fishbowl discussion with some youth from a variety of schools. After that, a panel discussion with parents and Principal Rachel Green and Elaine to keep giving us more information about our neighborhood schools and just the variety of schools that we have in Chicago. So with that, I'll introduce Ms. Susie Schneider from Generation All.
I'm going to call up some of our lovely students from our youth council and also some students that you might have seen before. Danelli Quiroz from Roosevelt High School, Karina Martinez from Curie, Stephanie from Uno Charter Soccer Academy, and Ray Burns, who is an alum of Foreman. So we're really happy to have you guys up here. Go ahead and come up. One of the students, Ray, is going to go first. He's going to be on the hot seat. And the other students are going to ask him a question about his high school experience. And then I will be out in the audience for one of you guys to ask Ray a question after the students ask him a question. And then we'll repeat that for Stephanie, for Karina, and for Danelli. So we did this in our youth council as a way for the young people to get to know each other because they're all from different high schools. And we wanted to give them also an opportunity to talk about their high school experience, you know, honestly, and also in a safe space. So I'll give the mic to you. So we're going to share this one mic. So Stephanie will ask the question first, and then give it back to you. Okay.
Great. So my first question for Ray is, do you think that your whole high school experience of 4 years actually prepared you for college?
Honestly, I would say yes. My 4 years in high school did prepare me for college, just because when I'm in my classes, I find myself getting a lot of things better than students who came from like schools that had a lot more funding than in mine. So I do feel like I am prepared for college.
How did you end up at your high school?
I ended up going to Foreman because I was commuting to school from middle school and it was like a 2-hour commute. I didn't want to commute anymore, so I just ended up going to middle school. I was close to where I was living at the time.
So what did you learn about yourself after your high school
now.
you hear that?
So what I'm offering your state of attending now?
Struggle a lot.
demonstrated all of the disparities that not only my school, but school like this, Roosevelt High School, was experiencing. And we were able to see how we could, even though we went to different high schools, different parts of the city, we could all relate and we could all work together to fix the problem that we were all experiencing.
What factors did you take into consideration when choosing your high school?
I think I had a very similar mindset that a lot of eighth graders have, that you want to go to a select enrollment school. And then when I didn't get into a select enrollment school, I saw all the different programs that all the high schools near me had. And one of the programs that caught my eye was the IB program. And also because all of my family had graduated from Curie, and so that definitely pulled me to Curie more.
What's one positive takeaway that you got from your school that you could really had you went somewhere else?
One positive experience or thing that I had to come from my high school is definitely the relationships I build with my teachers. My teachers aren't just there from 7 to 3. They're there for hours after school. But I had an experience when I was struggling in my math class, because I'm not very good at math, but my teacher stayed with me until 6:45 in the night, helping me study for the test the next day. And that test I got an A on, and it was an experience that I won't forget, because I could see all that my teachers do for me, and I know that people like my counselors, they will sit with me and they'll help me make all the decisions I have to make about college and about what to do with my life.
Any questions for Karina?
What is one tip you would give to a new freshman who's going to experience IB for the first time?
Going from a middle school where I wasn't actually challenged to going to a high school where it was, like being in a program where they do push you, always don't be afraid to seek help. I know that's super hard when it's a new school, it's new teachers, but don't be afraid to take that step, because it's definitely going to help you. I struggled with math all of my freshman year, and then I had C's freshman year, and I got B's sophomore year, and then my junior and senior year, I've gotten straight A's with math.
He's there in our meetings, which I also forgot to say that I'm president. decide whether I'm on the AI neighborhood school or if I'm a woman. And I was AI neighborhood school because I think something's a, like, you need to give it a chance.
Music program has to offer, and I think doing little things like that, people do pay attention.
stopping stigma, being off-center, you know, use social media as a tool and this being a school, learning because of teachers there, they're going to have more specific things about, like, well, you can all volunteer at this event, or we have the local friends of whatever high school, so I think like also getting involved with that is really important as well.
I hope you all enjoyed just maybe hear a little taste of what our students are thinking and experiencing in their high schools. Our youth council meets every Tuesday, and I know for me it's a really big blessing to be able to work with them every week. So I'm going to call up Linda Lutton at this point, and our panelists for our parent and researcher discussion. I'm sure you all have heard Linda's voice. You may not know her face as well, but she is a reporter at the WBEZ. She covers schools, education, and issues affecting youth. She has examined Chicago's drop-off crisis, racial segregation of schools, school performance, youth violence. She covered the 2012 Chicago Teachers Union strike and the closing of 50 public schools. Her work has been broadcast on many different public radio shows, and she's received many honors, including a 2014 Peabody Award and a 2004 Studs Terkel Award for excellence in reporting on Chicago's diverse neighborhoods. So please join me in welcoming Linda Lutton.
Chicago and
big cities like Chicago, that neighborhood schools must equal poor quality of education. And I think that's the perception that we need to change, and all stakeholders need to come together in order to do that. And we've been very fortunate here at Wells to be able to work with lots of community organizations, and we have some great partnerships in order to kind of change that perception. And my face manager is sitting right there. I think our incoming freshman class next year is going to be one of the largest ones we've had in a while because of that consistent work. Thank you.
Congratulations. Okay, I want to get to introduce the other panelists. I'm actually going to have them introduce themselves. We've got two parents. Because of this mic situation, I'm just going to pass the mic over. But I'd like you to tell us, Steve Posey, let's start with you. Why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your son, who's a senior at Kenwood Academy.
Thank you, Linda, and thank you for having me here today. Again, my name is Stephen Posey, and I do have a son that's a senior at Kenwood Academy. My wife and I, we relocated quite a bit for my job, and in coming back to Chicago, we had an opportunity to either move into Hyde Park or we thought about going to the suburbs. So we did a lot of the things that Eileen talked about in regards to looking at all the demographics and the numbers and things like that. And we found that Kenwood was ranked as good as any of the schools we were looking at in the suburbs. They sent kids to colleges just as much, and my wife was actually an alumnus. We also thought about the fact that it was a couple of blocks away from our house. Having lived the prior 5 years in Mississippi, there was no diversity. There was not a whole lot of freedom for kids to do their own things. I mean, as a matter of fact, we were the diversity. So, and coming back home, because we are from Chicago, we just wanted them to have a more well-rounded experience. But of course, coming back, we were thinking, gotta get them into Indiana, gotta get them into Lane Tech, the whole rat race of it all. But we found that, Kenwood was going to meet his needs. We believe that based on the information that we had, as well as just the logistics of it all and his ability to have some freedom and have some diversity in his experience. And I'm happy to say that all those things have been realized and that he'll be attending Florida A&M this fall.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and right,
Madison killed me, but yes, I have a daughter as well. And she's a fifth grader, but in coming back, so we were thinking, where are we going to send her to school? The neighborhood school, none of the kids are from the neighborhood. And I just found out being here today that Kenwood is only 50% neighborhood schools, neighborhood students. So in regards to my daughter's school, we dropped her off that first day. My wife cried just because of how it looked and the kids that were there. However, through her interactions with the teachers, with the principal, she's just up there every day establishing a rapport. And so therefore, Madison is doing great. They love her there. The school has achieved the highest marks they can get, and so we're very happy with that.
Great. We're gonna talk with Vinny Pendino. She's gonna introduce herself. She has a child coming into ninth grade. She's made a choice to send him, or they've made a choice, her family's made a choice to send her to the neighborhood high school, Amundsen. And I wanna ask you a little bit about that. So tell us a little bit about yourself, a little bit about that decision, and especially when you made that decision and why.
As she had mentioned, I've had an eighth grader and a sixth grader at Kentucky School. This decision, the process was kind of 10 years along. A lifetime ago, I was a Chicago public school teacher. I taught first grade in a neighborhood school that was a real gem, and I knew that they existed, but then I got married and succumbed to the story that we had to move to the suburbs. So we did it for 10 years. Two different summers, in fact, and we did not find that sense of community, and I kept saying once always believed in the neighborhood schools and how that is the core of the community. The funny story is before we moved out to the suburbs, we actually looked at a house across the street from Cooley, and we chose not to get it because the school wasn't what I wanted it to be. That house is now worth six times what it was.
And parents can actually get really involved in their schools, and they can learn a lot
more holistic kind of way. And that's another thing that I think you really want to pay attention to when you're looking at schools, when you're talking to people in the schools, what are they thinking in terms of developing students as learners, preparing them in terms of their opportunities for, you know, success in different areas, giving them challenges in more than just, you know, their academic classes, and really supporting them so they succeed in those challenges, because that's ultimately what's most important. That students, you know, learn, you know, that they can be successful, that they embrace challenges, they know they can be successful, and they know how to be successful.
Okay, Ms. Reed, I want to ask you, I looked up some numbers before I came here. So they're very depressing numbers for a neighborhood high school. You know, this neighborhood obviously has changed a lot. Your attendance number is pretty big. But 93% of CPS students who live in your boundary don't come to school here. That's what school choice has meant for Wells High School. And we know some other numbers that WBEZ hopes to report at some point, that if all kids in this boundary came here, you would have a tremendously diverse school. It would be about 30% white, about 30% Latino, and about 20% African American. How do you get there? And can you get there under the current policies that the district has?
I think the current policies that the district has segregates us in several ways. Income level, race, all the things that we want to get away from, right? So if choice wasn't the predominant driving force between how we select schools, high schools primarily, in the city, then we would have a school that was diverse like that, right? Because our school's doing well. It's not that our students come here and get a poor education. Our students go to four-year highly selective universities with full or bright scholarships. They have sports, extracurricular activities, three types of arts. So we provide them with a well-rounded, solid education with lots of support. The teachers and the staff members are passionate, dedicated. Our students are happy. Their hair is not falling out, lovely. Right? So we have all the things in place for our students to be successful, but the perception is out there that neighborhood schools are not good, or neighborhood schools serve a certain type of student population, and my child is not going to go to school with that type of student. So I think at a policy level, we can make some decisions where those things become non-issues, right? For example, if choice wasn't the driving force, instead, if we worked together to make sure that every single neighborhood school was supported to become the school of choice for that neighborhood, that they receive differentiated support, equity, and funding, you know, instead of spending millions and millions of dollars in building new schools, which we're still doing, there are existing schools out there that have a lot of capacity. This school can hold 1,400 students. We have less than 400. So instead of building a new school somewhere, why not think about what we can do on a policy level to get the students who live in this neighborhood to come here, right? We have 13 charter schools within our neighborhood boundary. That probably wasn't a very sound decision. You know, it was a poor decision that was made at some level at some point in time. I don't know to what extent the community was involved in that decision making. I know we weren't. As a school that has existed here for close to 90 years, we were not part of that decision making process. So those are the kind of things that we would need to consider when we think about the messages we send in what we value in our education, the messages we send when we make it a choice-based system and not a system where a student can walk to his or her neighborhood school and it is just as stellar as the neighborhood school that another student lives in, right? I have students here who come from way south, far west, and they take three buses, a train. Sometimes it takes them up to 2 hours to get to school. That should not be the case. Thank you.
while we're getting our first question answered, yeah, I was maybe, Steve, could you talk about, could you answer that question of that the students post of, you know, if you had to do it again, what about the allure of Whitney Young? Would you choose him one again if you had a choice?
That's easy, absolutely. I mean, what he was able to gain in just his own level of independence and what he has to learn as far as navigating the bureaucracy of his high school and knowing who to talk to and developing these relationships and developing his own independence without needing me to get him anywhere or you know, needing anything too much from his parents, it just it helped him grow. So, absolutely.
Places that I think people would write off as a low-performing school.
management leadership. And this is something that has been elevating. I'm hearing a lot more than test scores and test prep, and to focus more on the value of what a neighborhood school can do to bring, especially for a community, and how much it can elevate these opportunities. I'm interested in learning more about how your schools are promoting and developing this leadership and civic engagement, and then conversely, where do you think you'd like to see more of in your schools?
And can you repeat the question before you're giving your answer, please? We can't hear you.
So he wants to know about civic engagement and your school teaching civic engagement
to the kids,
to the students. And where you want to see more, you want to answer?
Sure. My kids are still in middle school, so I can't see the high schools. And I know the high schools have different service clubs and things like that, but in the middle school, they did different things like student council and different opportunities for them to find their talents. You know, my eighth grader's an artist, and she's always doing set design and different things like that. As a parent, that's something that I focus on. In my business, I have to do that, and so I actually take them with me to some of my professional development and personal development. I can't let them actually skip school to go with me to those because I feel like it's a great education, and I didn't have to worry about them. But that's what I do. Share books with them and different videos. There's a really great video, you guys should Google it. It's called The Lone Dancer, or The Dancer is a Leader. And it's this music festival, and this hippie is out dancing all by himself, and everybody's just staring at him. And then one person joins him, and then they're the two weirdos dancing by themselves. And within like 5 minutes, everyone rushes down to join them. And that video, I've shown that to my kids multiple times to talk about how you just have to be that lone dancer by yourself. So I'll show you.
Well, I guess we got it pretty easy with Kindlin because my son's required to complete 40 hours of customer service. I mean, community service. 40 hours of community service before he can graduate. But that's minimum, so he's got about double that, so he's good to go. But we are lucky in that it's a part of what they require.
We want to do that activity?
Karina, do you want to answer?
Yeah.
Can you come to the mic so we can hear you?
So, talking about civic engagement, definitely starts in the classroom. Had I not had most of the teachers that I experienced, I definitely wouldn't have the communications like I have generational or other opportunities. Like, I work on youth council. Which are both ways I got into with experiences from my teachers. And it kind of, it starts in the classroom, but you build up those skills to take it on your own. Like I recently, in the past like year and a half, became a youth organizer with the Brian Parker in the town. So that's it. It definitely leads to what you, like what I want to do in college. I don't want to stay with science, so if you like relate what you're working on in the classroom, then you take the leadership and put it into your own hands, you're able to do whatever.
Okay, one more question. To the back. We have somebody around the way. Oh, hi. So I would have said I agree so much with everything you've been saying about getting the word out that there are other options other than those examples of southern public schools. But there are probably, so I'm hearing more and more about, I have a sixth grader who is, at this moment convinced that she has to go to one of those schools, and I'm trying to say there are other schools and there are lots of smart kids that are not going to get into those schools because the competition is so, it's just fierce. It's And I know that, I'm hearing about, schools in my area that are good at Austin, and it's one in the others that I know do a really great job. And so getting the word out is probably, it's happening a little bit more. But there are still schools that are really struggling, and they're not really, in the same position as Wells and Austin. And so I would like to know what you think is the difference in those schools, the schools that are really still not maybe a safe place or a productive place or an achieving place. What makes the difference? How has your school been able to say, we're a great neighborhood school, and how have some of the other schools are unable to do that? And I think I just ask this from the perspective of how, as a community member, can we help to promote schools that are not
So I'm going to repeat that question, basically summarizing some schools. We're hearing about some schools do better, but we still hear about how some schools struggle. Why is that? What role does the community play? And I'll add part to that. In terms of what we hear about, is that just sort of buzz from middle class people? Is that what we mean when we say the schools are performing well yet? Is that what we really mean?
Thank you. So let me answer take a stab at answering your last part first, and then I'll get to the rest of your question. So I think when we think about performance, right, it's a very stringent and narrow set of criteria that we are using when we're thinking of performance. So if we're using the school quality rating policy, the SQRP, it has already predetermined metrics on there, such as standardized test scores, attendance, graduation rate, college enrollment persistence, and all that, all of which are very important metrics. What they don't measure are things such as supportive environment for students when it comes to their social-emotional growth, when it comes to helping students build peer relationships, when it comes to helping students build perseverance and bring all of those things that will help them be successful in college, right? Because only your research found that there's really not much of a difference between persistence rate of students who graduate from selective enrollment high schools and go to a four-year selective university versus a student who may graduate from a mid-tier quotes high school and goes to the same university. Am I right? That's what the research roughly had, more or less. So what sets a school apart that is being successful but may not show up as a level 1+ school in the performance metric are things that they do in order to reach all students. So I'm going to speak a little bit about what we do at Wells. We're not just, using a one-size-fit-all plan for all of our students, which sometimes may be the case in some schools that are assuming that they're getting students with high social capital because they're taking in students with high test scores. They're still teenagers. It's just because they know how to do well on tests and get really good grades doesn't mean that they know how to navigate peer relationships. Doesn't mean that they know how to automatically transition from elementary school to high school, which is a completely different ballgame. So at Wells, we pay attention to all of those things. We actually don't start our academic curriculum for about 2 weeks after school starts. We take the first 2 weeks in what we call suspended curriculum, where we're teaching students how to transition into high school, teaching them skills around conflict mediation and building strong peer networks and building relationships with their teachers, self-advocacy skills, persistence, grit, work ethic. All of those things that we can't assume that just because you're in high school that you know how to do. I would say that is a big reason why a lot of our students are successful, are on track. If you look at our on-track data, actually the former principal of Wells is sitting there in the back. Wells' on-track used to be at 49%. This was about a decade ago. We're now at 92%. Our demographics hasn't changed.
changes and the difference within the structures and the confines of our building, because we pay attention to systems and structures, we pay attention to what our students need, and we pay attention to things that are more than just academics. Because if you are struggling if you're struggling with relationships, if you're struggling with your study habits, if you're struggling with managing your time or your organizational skills, you are not going to be able to do well academically. So those other things also need to be taught and reinforced in order for them to be successful in high school and build the skills that they would need to be successful in college, in career, and in.
Did that answer your question?
We have one more question I want to take from the person right here.
Organizations. There's a donate button on both of our websites. Thank you to Ms. Fufu. For creating the program for tonight and doing so much work, and the awesome volunteers, the parents, students who helped us out. Thank you guys so much. Where are the students? Please come up here for a photo. Are they still here? The panelists? Did you all meet? Come on up. And also, there's still food out there, so feel free to grab food. We will have here for a few minutes, I'm sure. Thank you to Principal Lorena for hosting us today. Thank you so much. And thank you for your hard work. Thank you to all the CPS principals out here who are here and everywhere. As Elaine said, I think they're doing amazing work despite a lot of policies. Thank you all for coming. There are a lot of neighborhood school